All right. Well, now that we got that out of the way, we can talk about, unfortunately, Kofi Kingston all by himself losing to Bo Dallas. Now, Bo Dallas being all by himself means nothing, but it's just really unfortunate that Kofi is, because that probably means that the whole Big E, Xavier Woods, Kofi Kingston faction isn't going to happen. At least not now. I'm hoping that maybe they scrapped it temporarily because they weren't ready for it yet, and they'll pull it out some other time, like it's in their back pocket. But I have this gut feeling that it's just done.
And that's really disappointing to me, because you know from the episode of TwitWow when this debuted, I was all in.
Yeah, you were all in, but here's my thing, dude. I feel like one of the main reasons that this could have been interesting is because at one point somebody tweeted Xavier Woods something about how, hey, Xavier, when is the new Nation of Domination debuting? And he said something about how, I don't know, because if I were to start a faction, it would be based on intelligence and not on the color of people's skin. And I really liked that answer. And I just really, like, after that tweet, I was like, please let them do something with this. But it's looking relatively unlikely.
I felt like that could have, really for all three of them, but it especially could have done wonders for Woods. We could have explored a side of him that we hadn't really seen, like, even if you want
to. See, and to me,
back.
The only person in that group that it wouldn't have been super interesting for would have been Big E, because we've seen heel Big E before. But with Woods, he would have had the opportunity to be the mouthpiece, and Xavier Woods as a mouthpiece is something that I am extremely excited about, the prospect of seeing. Plus, we would have gotten to see heel Kofi, which is something we've never seen before, and after seeing it one time on an episode of Main Event, it was Main Event, we're probably never going to see it again.
Yeah, it really sucks, and that's why, I don't know if this was a Kevin Dunn thing, a Triple H thing, because I keep thinking back to the words of Triple H, and they never left me, and it really pertained to NXT talent, but I think if you modify it a little bit, you can make it apply to any angle, any action you're going to undertake on a TV product. Don't debut an NXT talent unless you have something set up for them to do, because Triple H, being very protective of his baby, he wants to make sure that they're not just coming in like a deer in the headlights, you know, that they have some semblance of direction. Well, I think it should be the same thing when you're debuting any kind of an angle, any kind of an act. Don't just put it out there and then pull back because maybe you didn't devote enough thought to it or this or that. If you're going to put it out, I'm assuming, as the viewer, you have an end game for it. You have a plan for it. And it's just sad that that wasn't the case with this faction. And I saw the answer you were talking about, Ashton, on Xavier Woods' Twitter. I loved it too, and he even did the hashtag, it's 2014, which shows me that Xavier Woods recognizes the time period that he's in.
Yeah, you know what, though, dude? I think, honestly, even though I think that there was so much potential in a group like that, I'm going to get crucified for this, I know it. I'm almost glad that they aren't going through with it, because, and I think this is where a lot of people are overlooking it, and including me up until right about now when I realized it, there was no way for the WWE to do this that would work. Because if they would try to do it the classic traditional wrestling way, it would have been absolutely obliterated by people like you and me and wrestling news sites and any kind of critic that could get their hands on it for being racially insensitive and putting forward negative stereotypes in the 21st century. So right. I get that. If they would have tried a different angle, I think that it wouldn't have been received well, because let's face it, as much as we don't want to try and admit it, as much as we want to look our freaking skeletons in the face, or as much as we want to just take our skeletons and hide them away in the closet and we're afraid to look them in the face, I think that America still has that inner racism where no matter how much this group would be pushed forward as a group that values intelligence over race, they would have been booed for being, not even necessarily for being black, but for the fact that, like the Damian Sandow thing. if you act smarter than everybody else, you're going to get booed. And the fact that they all were black guys, people would have been like, oh, well, now everyone's booing at the black guys, so America's super duper racist now. And even if it wouldn't have necessarily, I think it would have had something to do with it, because the idea that these three black guys think they're smarter than everyone else, white people would have been offended. And I'm not trying to say all white people. I'm just saying there are a lot of white people, specifically in the South, that would have been offended.
Right, because there's this perception that they have that would just come in major conflict with what WWE was presenting.
Right, and I think that what it comes down to, and this is why I still have hope that they're keeping it in their back pocket, I don't think that America would have been ready for that faction yet.
Right. And, dude, to kind of build on that point, I think my biggest worry was something that you actually mentioned the very first night they debuted. And that would be the commentary.
Yes.
I feel like this gimmick is so dependent, as is anything, as a general rule. And I think I've said this, if not on Twitter, I know I've said this in the past when I've talked wrestling to people who know my previous body of work, that commentary is so important to get anything over. And do you really think that JBL, Jerry Lawler, and even to a degree Michael Cole, because he loves joshing around and palling around with JBL and King, it's nothing against him personally, it's just they all get swept up in it, that they would have treated this with the gravity and the dignity that it deserves for the message they were trying to get across? That there was this militant intellectual mentality presented by this group because they had been kept down, they wanted bigger spots because they're talented and intelligent enough. And I think they would have just made it seem like, particularly the Jerry Lawlers and maybe Cole, maybe JBL would have defended them solely because he's the heel commentator, but I'm even skeptical of that, because we've criticized JBL's commentary in the past, so it goes without saying. They would have made it seem like instead of them having genuine motivations and merits in their contentions, it would have just been like, these guys have sour grapes. And that's
I know this is going to sound a little bit over the top, but I think that it's really relevant right now. I see commentary as a bunch of kids. Like, JBL is like a freaking 7-year-old. He's just throwing around all these random words, and he's saying, Moggle, Moggle, we fought on Friday nights, Moggle, 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 and he's just obnoxious, and he's a freaking 6-year-old. Michael Cole is like a 12 or 13 year old where, yeah, he's trying to be a little bit more mature. But on that same note, he still gets drawn in by JBL poking and prodding him and calling him names and telling him that he's, you're all black helicopters tonight, Moggle. And then you've got freaking Lawler, who is like a really horny 16 year old dude who just cares about women. And really, I mean, the ironic thing is the 16-year-old women would be the ones that Lawler goes after, but that's a different topic for a different time. But you get the idea. And then this faction would have been like a hemophiliac baby in the hands of this 6, 12, or 13, and 16-year-old. And it's just – you need to really handle this kind of faction with – intense care and just nurture it and really choose your words wisely. And then you put it in the hands of these little kids and they're throwing it around and punting it like a freaking Ike on South Park.
Or like Snitsky does to plastic dolls.
It wasn't his fault though, John.
And you know, Ashton, I get completely what you're saying, and I want everybody to understand, we're not saying that we don't want WWE to take risks and be daring with certain angles, but if you're going to do it, have the competency to do it. What was the one thing you said to me when I said Cameron could be a top female heel? Just because you think you should do something doesn't mean that you actually should do it.
It's actually a quote from Jurassic Park where these people spent so much time trying to figure out if they could do it that they didn't stop to ask themselves if they should.
And that, I think, was the case with this angle when they tried doing it the first time.
Yeah.
They did it. I think maybe they even had some of the similar thoughts that we've had. Maybe. I'm just saying. And maybe they thought, you know what? It's too big a gamble. There are too many controversial elements to this. Let's pull it back. Because you know what? I think after things like Muhammad Hassan and stuff like that, I feel like they're very cautious with how they approach things. I'm actually...
Yeah, and dude, that's a perfect example. Muhammad Hassan was just a respectable, Arab American who was trying to get his rights back, and he got booed relentlessly. And for what? For speaking the truth. If this group would have done that, again, they would have been booed relentlessly. And here's my thing. Unless you want your commentators to all look like heel douchebags, they have to go with what the crowd says. So if the crowd's booing, your commentators don't really have much of a choice but to say that whoever the crowd is booing is wrong.
I hate to almost make it seem like the onus is on us, the wrestling fan, to make this work, but it's funny that we're talking about this side of it, Ashton, because then when you look at the Swagger Rusev angle, what was the one thing that you and I consistently said virtually every episode where this was a main talking point? That
I can't believe it's still working in 2014. I
can't believe it's still working in 2014 because Lana would talk about things like Edward Snowden, things like our foreign policy, this and that, and she'd be right on the money. But what would Zeb Coulter say? He'd pull
America.
Out... Yeah, the American exceptionalism. America, the glittering generalities, which is the oldest propaganda trick in the book. And not to be insulting, I'm just stating it for what it is, because you guys heard the crowd reactions just like we did. They lapped it up. They lapped it up, and they loved it.
Yep.
Because I feel like if you were to try and present a contrary view to what the country you reside in is... It creates this irreconciliation mentally that they just can't come to terms with, and they react violently towards it. I think that the term for it is cognitive dissonance, actually. And I think that's what these people experience when they see their country being insulted, and they just can't reconcile that way. I thought America was the greatest country on earth. So, it sucks, but it's the way it is.
Oh, that's an entirely different subject for a very different commentary. So,
yeah.
As we were saying, Bo Dallas picked up the win over Kofi Kingston.
And then, Bo saying, Kofi, it's not your fault. You're not Jack Swagger. He failed his country, blah, blah, blah. And then he looks to Kofi and he says, you both just need to believe. And then he turns around. Swagger nails that amateur slam that I was talking about earlier. Leaves the ring.
Yeah, and by the way, I just want to point this out. The crowd booed this, and rightfully so. This was a really heelish move for Swagger to go for.
Yeah. Because really, Bo hasn't even... If Bo had taken Swagger when he was down, say, after his match against Rollins on SmackDown where he was curb-stomped and just seemed out, and Bo took his lifeless body and nailed a running Bo dog, off the steel steps onto the floor, then I could understand Swagger doing it. But really,
Bo
all
has
Bo
not
has done...
initiated any physical contact whatsoever with Swagger.
Exactly, Ashton. Exactly. It's just been that verbal hazing.
To top it all off, even if Bo had gotten physical with Swagger at one point, Swagger did this after Bo had already participated in a match. So he was already exhausted from the match, and Swagger decides to take advantage. Like, if that's not the heeliest thing that anyone did tonight, I don't know what is.
Exactly, dude. I mean, I couldn't agree with you more. Nothing really to say than that. Do you want to move on?